Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar Series, where great professors teach you. My name is Jack Garrett, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled Journeys of the Great Explorers, Columbus to Cook. Your professor is Glyn Williams, Emeritus Professor of History at Queen Mary, University of London. Dr. Williams has traveled and lectured in the United States, Canada, the West Indies, and Jamaica, and has held visiting appointments at many universities outside Britain. His dozen books and 30 articles include Voyages of Delusion, The Search for the Northwest Passage in the Age of Reason, The Prize of All the Oceans, The Triumph and Tragedy of Anson's Voyage Round the World, The Voyages of Captain Cook, The Great South Sea, English Voyages and Encounters, 1570 to 1750, and Voyages to Hudson Bay in Search of a Northwest Passage, 1741 to 1747. In July 1999, he was presented with a volume of essays, Pacific Empires, by colleagues and former students, published in his honor by Melbourne University Press. In the 15th and 16th centuries, superstitious people might have warned an explorer sailing west from Europe that he was doomed to fall off the edge of the world. At the very least, they might have said, the explorer and his sailors would suffer horribly and never be seen alive again. Many people at that time knew the earth was round, but popular misconceptions held that even if this were so, surely the countries across the sea would be populated with monsters and demons. For all the grim warnings, nobody could have predicted that the explorers would not sail off the edge of the world, but into an entirely new one. Men like Columbus, Bering, Cook, and Da Gama paved the way for conquest and colonization in the Americas and the South Pacific. They determined what the world would look like for centuries to come. Their stories, tales of starvation, extremity, violence, and betrayal, are the heritage of modern society. Whether one lives in the Americas, Europe, or Asia, the actions of the great explorers had a profound impact on the course of human civilization. They made us what we are today. A mixture of bravery, cruelty, obsession, and idealism, the great explorers still have a message for us from the oceans and forests where they risked their lives, and sometimes lost them, in the pursuit of fortune, glory, and the unknown. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites, a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students, and yes, of course, a final exam. And now we begin Journeys of the Great Explorers, Columbus to Cook, Lecture 1. The World Before Columbus. And now, Professor Williams.
Welcome to the course. We shall be looking at one of the most dramatic periods in world history, the age of Europe's discovery of the world. We shall be going from Columbus and Da Gama in the late 15th century to the voyages of James Cook in the late 18th century. The extent of the change can be seen if we compare a pre-Columbian map, which would show no knowledge, either of the Americas or the Pacific, with one of about, say, 1800, in terms of projection, scale, content, that would resemble, at least in continental outline, one of today's maps. In these lectures, we'll be looking at the more important of the discovery voyages, the individual characteristics of their commanders, the endurance of their crews, and together with accounts of individual voyages, there will be lectures which explain more technical aspects of the great voyages, improvements in ship design and navigation, the constraints which wind and current brought to the navigator, how men lived on board ship, what sort of problems of health did they have, and what sort of problems of discipline did their captain face. We'll be paying special attention to the controversies that surround many of the voyages, and which I hope you may be able to investigate in more detail by way of the recommended reading that accompanies the course. All I want to say here is that some of the most important problems in history arose from the explorers' encounters with the peoples of the world outside Europe. And among the questions I want to look at in this lecture are, firstly, did Norse sailors reach America 500 years before Columbus? And secondly, if so, are they the true discoverers of America? And finally, why did Europeans think of the Atlantic as an island-filled ocean? I want to begin by stressing how little knowledge men of the late medieval period had of the world they lived in. Many had never moved outside their own locality, no further than the nearest town, perhaps a few miles away. Few would have travelled more than perhaps 50 miles. There were exceptions, of course. There were soldiers, sailors, itinerant merchants, and so on. But for most people, their world was a patch of land a few square miles across with a few hundred inhabitants. This ignorance was reflected on a different scale among the learned of Europe. They knew now that the earth was round, even though there was a lingering belief among some that it was flat. But they did not know how big it was. We today know more about outer space than the scholars of 1400 knew about the world. Let's illustrate this by looking at a world map of the 15th century. It was filled with three great landmasses, Europe, Asia, and Africa. But it would have no sign of the Americas or of Australia, and there would be a massive preponderance of land overseas. There were, it was true, trading and other exchanges between the three known continents, sometimes of a violent military character, the Crusades, for example. Most lucrative was the overland trade in Asian spices and silks. This was dominated at its consumer end by Venice on one side of the Mediterranean and Egypt on the other. This trade was interrupted when the Mongol conquest of the 13th century under the leadership of Genghis Khan spread destruction across huge areas of Asia from China to Persia, and at its high water mark even reached the Balkans and the Middle East. But once the fighting died down, much of Asia was left under the unified control of the Mongols. We consider the Mongols generally as a destructive, violent force, but in fact, they made long-distance travel easier, especially as they established a system of posts where travellers could change horses. So we now find that diplomats, missionaries, and traders are beginning to visit the lands under Mongol rule, and by the 14th century, merchants from Genoa and Venice had opened a direct trade with India and China. One of the problems is that few of these left any record of their travels, but the exception was the Venetian merchant Marco Polo, not only one of the world's great travellers, but also one of the world's great travel writers, and his account was to influence explorers up to and beyond the time of Columbus. Marco Polo travelled with members of his family, and he reached China and the court of the great Khan, Kublai Khan. Marco Polo spent 17 years as an official of the Mongol ruler, and during this time he continued to travel widely through lands totally unknown to Europeans. In the 1290s, he eventually returned to Venice, and this, in his own right, was a colossal journey or series of journeys. He made the journey by sea, first from China to Java, then to India, then to Persia, and finally to Constantinople and back to the Mediterranean. and on his return his adventures were not finished. He became involved in local wars, was taken prisoner, and it was while he was in prison that he wrote a narrative of his travels that was soon to be translated into all the main European languages. It was a mix of fact and fiction, of detailed observation and fanciful elaboration. So much so that some, both at the time and ever since, have queried whether Marco Polo ever made the travels described. For example, he doesn't mention the Great Wall of China. Now, you would expect a traveller who saw the Great Wall, then or now, to mention it at least. Marco Polo doesn't. His most recent biographer has argued persuasively that Marco Polo did visit China. He didn't see all the places he wrote about, but there's no doubting the impact that his description of the riches of the East had, both on his contemporaries and those who came later. The account was first printed in 1483, and we know that Columbus possessed a copy. It survives, and you can see handwritten notes in the margin by Columbus. And it would be very exciting to think that Columbus read and took notice of Marco Polo before he sailed across the Atlantic in 1492. Well, there's a snag. We don't actually know when Columbus read that copy, and we don't know when he made the notes. It could have been after 1492, but it's an interesting thought. It was soon after Polo's visit that major changes began to take place in the Mongol Empire. The Western Khans became Muslim, and they blocked Christian travellers. So there are no more Marco Polos. And then in the mid-15th century, the Ming Dynasty, the Buddhist dynasty, established itself in China. And that took up an adamantly anti-foreign stance. No more European visitors. So in Europe, Polo's account continued to be read, but there are problems with it. First of all, there are problems of possible inaccuracies, certainly of omissions, but a second problem, that he described an Asian world that had changed dramatically since his visit. But that doesn't really affect the major point. Marco Polo was read and was immensely influential in Europe. Marco Polo's travels were factual in basis, but there were also many imaginary travels and imaginary kingdoms that found their way into the European imagination. Among them, and is an enduring myth, was that of Prester John, a wealthy Christian emperor whose domain was thought to be somewhere in Asia. And it was linked with the Old Testament and the Bible. Was it the terrestrial paradise, perhaps? Was the fountain of youth somewhere near? If so, that would explain why Prester John, who appears as an individual, seems to have lived for century after century. And the myth was reinforced by a document of the 12th century, which actually has a letter from Prester John to the Byzantine Empire at Constantinople. It described the monarch and it described his kingdom. We now know that letter was one among the many forgeries of the late medieval period. And curiously, Prester John's kingdom now starts to migrate. From being in Asia, it moves west and it lands up in Africa, in East Africa, Ethiopia. And for centuries, Europeans assumed that Prester John lived somewhere inland from the coast of East Africa. And it has another long spell of life. And what we're looking at are incentives that are taking Europeans outside their own continent, reasons why they should want to investigate the world outside. But for every incentive, there was a disincentive. Many Europeans regarded the outside world with apprehension, with suspicion. For every Christian monarch, they imagined, for every fabulous and wealthy kingdom they imagined, there was something darker. Outside the battlements of medieval Christianity swirled misty and monstrous shapes. Giants, troglodytes, men with six arms, unipeds, formidable Amazon fighting women, cannibals, hermaphrodites, aberrant subhuman figures lurking on the edges of the known world. And the accounts of the first voyages we'll be looking at reflect a quite fearful expectation. After his first voyage, Columbus wrote, almost apologetically, "I have so far found no human monstrosities as many expected." But later on, Vespucci, Amerigo Vespucci, describing his explorations on the coast of South America, made up for this with lurid details of polygamy, human sacrifice, and cannibalism among the native inhabitants. And the illustrations that accompany many of the voyage narratives show all this in gory detail. As far as Africa was concerned, European contacts were limited to the north, to the Mediterranean coast. There, European merchants traded, and you find European mercenaries are serving in the Muslim armies. But no Europeans, to our knowledge, accompanied the trading caravans that crossed the Sahara Desert. And more significant were the probes by seaborne expeditions which went out of the Mediterranean through the Strait of Gibraltar into the Atlantic and then turned south along the coast of West Africa. The first recorded attempt to explore that coast was made by the Vivaldi brothers from Genoa in 1291. They simply disappeared from view. We have no idea how far they got along the African coast. They may have been among the great heroic explorers of the past, but we just don't know. Again, there were disincentives. Among them was the lingering belief in a very old thesis, you can date it back to Aristotle in the period of classical Greece, who argued that the earth was divided into five climatic zones: North Pole, South Pole, frigid and icy. Then the temperate zones. But then, on each side of the equator, a fearful torrid zone where the land was uninhabitable and the sea boiled. How was one going to make that journey along the West African coast with that looming in front of one, the sea that boiled? It was to be a slow process, and something which I think has only been realized fairly recently are the huge strides that the Chinese were making in this period in their knowledge of Africa. There's a series of Chinese fleets in the early 15th century which certainly reached the east coast of Africa. Whether they rounded the Cape of Good Hope and got into the Atlantic, we don't know. It's a matter of speculation. But it's a salutary corrective to ideas of European seaborne dominance at this time to realize the scale of the Chinese effort. Their ships dominated the trade of the Eastern Seas. And between 1405 and 1433, Admiral Cheng Ho organized seven expeditions, which in the end reached across the Indian Ocean and to the east coast of Africa. These are huge fleets. They dwarf any European venture of the period. The very first expedition seems to have consisted of more than 60 ships and many thousands men. Their purpose was as much diplomatic as commercial. They were really showing the flag. They were to make treaties with foreign rulers. They were to demonstrate the power of the Chinese emperor. Their ships were certainly seaworthy enough to get round the Cape of Good Hope. And one recent, intriguing interpretation insists that they went much farther. They went into the Atlantic. They reached America. They reached Greenland. And in the southern oceans, they discovered Australia. It's a nice thesis, but unfortunately the direct evidence doesn't exist. The 1433 Chinese voyage was the last, for reasons that are not altogether clear. The Chinese now withdraw within their own frontiers, and trade with the foreigners, if not prohibited, was very much frowned upon. This withdrawal, outside European sight and knowledge, was to help the Portuguese later on to find and exploit a sea route to the Indies. In terms of general European knowledge of the outside world, there had not been much development from ancient times. When three continents were known, there were vague reports of further lands in the Antipodes. There was certainly no anticipation in Europe that there was a huge continent lying across the ocean. There was speculation, of course. It would be very strange if the maritime nations of Europe, those on the western fringes, didn't think about what lay beyond the horizon of the ocean to their west. But in the medieval period, what lay in the ocean, according to most European geographers, were islands, not continents. There was the island of Seven Cities. This was supposedly founded by seven bishops who fled west across the ocean from Portugal at the time of the Moors' invasion in the 8th century. And maps of the period just before Columbus show the island dotted in various parts of the Atlantic, often given a name, Antilia, the opposite island. Another story was that of the Irish bishop, St. Brendan, who in the 6th century undoubtedly made voyages which took him from Ireland to various island groups lying off the British mainland. Certainly the Shetlands and the Hebrides, possibly even the Faroes farther north. By about the year 1000, the story of his voyages appeared in a much more elaborate form and took him to wondrous lands. And some scholars have argued he got to Iceland because he talks about flaming mountains of snow, perhaps to the Caribbean islands. All that one can say is, again, there is little direct evidence of this. Then there were the Norsemen, hemmed in on their narrow coastal strips in Scandinavia, who put to sea in search of land and plunder. And they sail in open, square-sailed vessels. They reached Iceland, and then Greenland. And by the end of the 10th century, they are finding lands west of Greenland. And they give them names, Markland, Vinland, Helluland. Was this America? Scholars agree that it was. They're right on the fringes of the North American continent, probably Baffin Island, Labrador, and Newfoundland. The locations of these lands have been hotly disputed by historians. So has been the question of how far south the Norse reached. Did they set up inland settlements on the American continent? Well, investigation has not been helped by various fakes and forgeries, runic stones, Viking towers, which have been presented as genuine relics of a North presence. But what we now know for certain is that there was a Norse settlement on the northeast coast of Newfoundland. It was discovered in the 1960s and it was extensively excavated. There, house foundations have been found, which would have held about 80 people. Though we're not quite certain whether they wintered there or whether these were merely summer bases. Despite the uncertainties, the Norse were the first Europeans known to have discovered parts of America. And this is 5 centuries before Columbus. It was, as you will have noticed, a step-by-step, cumulative process. The American settlement, or perhaps settlements, would have been short-lived, and climatic changes led in the end to the abandonment of the Greenland colony from which the expeditions had sailed. It's ironic, tales about the Seven Cities, totally fanciful, and about St. Brendan, probably fanciful, continued to circulate in late medieval Europe. But knowledge of the Norse discoveries vanished. It's a sign probably of the distance, both geographical and intellectual, between Scandinavia and the Mediterranean. Not until the late 16th century did geographers hear about the Norse discoveries, and then they attempted to fit them in with the maps produced by Columbus and his successors. The medieval belief that the Western Ocean was full of islands was reinforced by the voyages of sailors from the Mediterranean, out through the Strait of Gibraltar and into the open Atlantic. They found a succession of islands or island groups: Madeira, the Canary Islands, the Azores. Some were identified with the islands of myth and legend, but more often the islands were pushed further and further west into the ocean. So you find maps which show, looking out from Europe, 2 island chains. Antilia, the islands of 7 cities, the Fortunate Isles of St. Brendan, and so on. And these are fairly near Europe still. But further west still are the lands described by Marco Polo, especially Kapangu, Japan, and Cathay, China. So here you can see the confusion that paves the way for Columbus's first voyage. If you sail west through the first chain of islands, you will meet the outlying islands of the Asian continent. But what is quite crucial, and we'll be referring to this time and time again, these European incursions into the Atlantic discovered not only islands, but wind systems. This is the age of the sailing ship. Knowledge of the wind systems was essential to effective discovery. And so when Columbus sailed in 1492, he had knowledge of the wind system, which took him into and then across the Atlantic. Columbus was a very experienced navigator and merchant long before 1492. He had probably sailed to Iceland in a Bristol ship. He had probably sailed south along the coast of West Africa in Portuguese ships. And there's some evidence that he had picked up knowledge of a Bristol voyage which may or may not have reached America. The letter was written in 1498 to Columbus. That's 6 years after his first Atlantic crossing. And he was reminded that English seamen had found land across the Atlantic in times past. That was the phrase used. As your lordship knows. So, had Bristol navigators found America before Columbus? And secondly, if so, did Columbus know about this? I think one must say that to argue this is stretching the evidence to the limit, and perhaps beyond. And finally, away from the world of practical seamen, the 15th century was marked by the rediscovery of the writings and maps of a 2nd century geographer, Ptolemy, from Alexandria in Egypt. And by the 1480s, there were printed copies of his world map. and this represented an influential view of the world just before the great age of seaborne exploration. Africa was shown linked to an Antarctic continent. So the Indian Ocean is landlocked. And it was, of course, a world without America. In compensation for the lost continent, the lack of America, the old world of Asia and Europe was elongated. And since the size of the globe was underestimated by about a quarter, the two eras made it appear that Western Europe and Eastern Asia, the fringes of each continent, were not impossibly far apart. Even closer in time and outlook to Columbus was the first surviving terrestrial globe of 1492 by Martin Behaim. And this showed an Atlantic Ocean filled with a familiar mix of islands stretching out to the west, the Canaries, Antilia, and so on. And then the islands of Cipango and Cathay, lying off an unexplored north-south coastline, that of Asia. The way was open for Columbus's first voyage, and in my next lecture, I want to be looking at this quite extraordinary event, which I think you can argue was to change the history of the world.
Journeys of the Great Explorers, Columbus to Cook, Lecture 2, The Voyages of Christopher Columbus.
In our last lecture, you remember, we looked at European concepts of the world in the 15th century, before Columbus, and we saw that they had a very strong feeling of Asia, the desirability of getting to Asia, of taking the riches of Asia back to Europe, perhaps by a different route from the old-fashioned traditional one across the Levant into the Eastern Mediterranean. And today I want to move to the last decades of the 15th century, which saw two very different European attempts to find a sea route to Asia. One series of voyages, and we'll look at these in more detail in our next lecture, was made by Portuguese seamen. After edging down the coast of West Africa, they eventually rounded the Cape of Good Hope and found the way to India, across the Indian Ocean. Now, this process was a slow and cumulative one, and I think you can see that it was really the search for a route to a destination that was already known. By contrast, and this is what we're going to be looking at now, there was the quest for a very different westward route to Asia, much less predictable, represented by a single daring crossing of the Atlantic in 1492 by Christopher Columbus. Columbus was the son of a Genoese weaver. He was later a merchant. He was a navigator, an explorer, a colonial administrator. The voyage of 1492 was the most famous discovery voyage in history. And among the questions I want you to consider is whether Columbus's reputation was actually deserved. And why did he cling all his life to the notion that what he had found across the Atlantic was Asia? And is it so that his visionary nature, because he was a visionary, has obscured what some people would argue was his real skill as a marvellous practical seaman? Columbus's first Atlantic voyage was the result of much individual perseverance by him, and I think one must add, much misunderstanding of world geography. He had spent the 1470s voyaging in the Mediterranean, down the West African coast, with Portuguese ships, in the Eastern Atlantic, with a call almost certainly at Madeira, and in Northern European waters, including possibly a visit to Bristol, and perhaps a voyage north to Iceland. Columbus himself said, "I have sailed all the seas that men have sailed, except for the Indian Ocean." Certainly, he was one of the most experienced navigators of his time. And at some stage during these voyages, and as with so many events in Columbus's life, the timing is not at all clear, he began making plans for westward exploration into the Atlantic. He was not looking for a new continent. He was looking for an old one. He was looking for the Asia of Marco Polo. Asia, with its spices, its silks, its accessible wealth. And he had a grand design, and that grand design was based on two fundamental misconceptions. First of all, that the globe was much smaller than it actually is, and secondly, that Asia extended much farther east than it does. The cumulative error was huge. Columbus calculated that the distance from the Canary Islands, these were to be his starting off point off the northwest coast of Africa, across to the island of Kapango, or Japan, which Marco Polo had described, though he'd never visited it, was round about 2,400 miles. In actual fact, it's 10,000 miles and more. Now, Columbus was not the only one to hold this thesis based on a misunderstanding of world geography. But what Columbus did was to take every factor that favoured his argument and to disregard every factor that went the other way. So one finds, for example, back in 1474, Toscanelli from Florence persuaded the Portuguese crown to send ships into the Atlantic to find, first of all, some of the islands there, but, he said, Kapango, or Japan, beyond it. They were blown back by contrary winds west of the Azores, and they hardly made a start on the crossing of the Atlantic. But we know that in 1481, Columbus was actually in touch with Toscanelli and may have been encouraged by Toscanelli to try again. So there are all sorts of influences on Columbus. It's also possible that Columbus heard about Bristol voyages into the Atlantic in search of islands as well as fishing grounds. And we saw in our last lecture that there's that interesting letter after Columbus crossed the Atlantic, which reminded him he had heard about Bristol mariners and a Bristol search for new lands. What is certain is that by 1484, Columbus had drawn up a specific project, revolutionary in idea, revolutionary in concept, to sail due west across the Atlantic to the eastern lands of Asia. It was so daring that that project was turned down, first of all by Portugal, then by France, and then by Spain. It was a huge leap into the unknown. In a way, for example, that the Portuguese voyages down the west coast of Africa, which we'll look at in our next lecture, were not. They were going from one known point to the next. And Columbus's cause, one must say, was not helped by the extravagant demands he made for rewards and honours. He was not really a supplicant, if you like. He was making demands. It was Spain that paid most serious attention to Columbus's great plan. Spain is going through an interesting and formative part of its history. It's just been united under the twin rulers Isabel of Castile and Ferdinand of Aragon. And they set up, and there's a familiar ring to this, committees of experts to look at Columbus and his plan. And again, there's something familiar about the reports of those committees which turned down the plan. It was altogether too unconventional, too daring for a government-appointed committee to give support to. Columbus now had a turn of luck. He was favoured by two quite different events. He had been in Portugal when Bartholomew Diaz returned in 1488 from his voyage to the Cape of Good Hope, and we'll be hearing a lot more about that voyage in the next lecture. The Cape of Good Hope was so far south that Columbus was able to argue that the Portuguese route across the Indian Ocean to India and points further east would be intolerably long and difficult. What he was proposing was a short route directly across the Atlantic. So the voyage of Diaz, which has come down to us as one of the great discovery voyages, was used by Columbus to favour his own very, very different plan. Then secondly, there was the conquest of Granada in southern Spain in early 1492 by the Spanish monarchy, which marked the expulsion of the Moors, the Muslims, from Spain, and the end of a long campaign by the Spanish monarchy that had consumed much of its energies and finances over the decades. So Isabel, who was really Columbus's patron, and Ferdinand made the decision to fit out an expedition. It was not a very costly affair. The crown itself wasn't bearing much of the financial burden. A Genoese banker weighed in with money. A treasury official put some of his savings into the expedition. And there were just to be three rather small vessels involved. Columbus himself was to receive a share of the profits made from his discoveries, and that share was 1/10, together with a new title. If he was successful, he would be called Admiral of the Ocean Sea. The wording of that title is significant. It shows that Columbus was not sent, from an official point of view, to look for new continents, but rather for islands in the ocean that would provide stepping stones on a new route to Asia. For all its portentous consequences, Columbus's first crossing of the Atlantic with those three small ships was a low-key affair. Its success stemmed from his knowledge of the wind systems of the eastern Atlantic, and his decision to sail, first of all, south to the Canaries, from where he picked up the northeast trade winds, which took him across the Atlantic. He then planned to return farther north, following the westerlies, which would take him, he hoped, to the Azores and so back to Europe. In many ways, Columbus was an obsessive, a visionary, but he was also a very fine, practical seaman. The little fleet left the Canaries on the 6th of September 1492 and sailed west into the unknown. It was a smooth, uneventful voyage, though there is evidence of increasing crew anxiety. Try and put yourself in the place of the crew, and how much they knew about their destination, we don't know. But as the days passed, as the weeks passed, the winds blew steadily from the east, which was fine for Columbus, but no land was sighted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.